Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first item on the agenda is a decision on taking items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 is the committee's annual report, and item 5 is the consideration of the evidence that we will have heard this morning from the Scottish Government's Climate Change and Environmental Governance Stocktake. Are we agreed to take these matters in private? We are agreed. Our second item of business this morning is consideration of the Circular Economy Scotland Bill at stage 2, and it is day 4. Gosh, how time flies when you're having fun. I welcome to the meeting Gillian Martin, the Minister for Climate Action, and her supporting officials. I also welcome Sarah Byatt, Maurice Golden, and Graham Simpson, who are here. At last week's meeting, the committee ended the consideration of the bill for the day at section 13 having been agreed, and amendments 66 and 67 having been disposed of. So, we'll now call the amendment in my name, grouped with amendment 120, and I am to either move amendment 119 and speak to both amendments in the group. So I had hoped to get this dealt with last week. It's a fairly simple amendment, which I wish to move on my behalf, and it's to do with littering from private vehicles. But before I go into the details of that, I would remind members that as a farmer in Murray with land holdings, I experience fly tipping on a regular basis, whether it be from moving vehicles or from other vehicles that just stop and turf stuff out the back. So it can be anything from bottles to builder's rubble. And from my point of view, bottles cause immense problems because it chokes and kills the cows and the calves that I have. So I am a little bit more bought into this problem, perhaps, than some others. But I know everyone faces it. Now, what I would say is I have seen in my lifetime various campaigns to stop this. Dumb dumping, don't be a tosser. All these campaigns have been out there to stop people throwing rubbish out of the windows. But yet, when we go up the A9, as I did on Thursday night, just before Dalnacardoch on the bend, or sorry, just after Dalnacardoch on the bend there of the A9 on the dual carriageway, there is a phenomenal amount of rubbish, which is obviously accumulated by people throwing stuff out of windows on places where they think they cannot be seen. And it is disgusting. And we will all have places like that within our constituency where people just throw it out of the window because they don't care. Now, the problem is, in my mind, is that the issues with that are simple, is that we have to pay somebody to come along and clear it all up. And because it's in the most dangerous places on the road with no sight lines, for the reason why it's dumping, we are often putting their lives at risk to clear it up. And therefore, I believe we should send a very strong signal to those people that believe it is appropriate to throw things out of the window, that it is not appropriate, which is why my two amendments are such. One is to increase the penalty charge to a minimum of £500, and the other one is ancillary to that, to make sure that it can be carried through. Now, people say that throwing rubbish out of the window should be the point of a fixed penalty notice. It can be. But the beauty of this amendment is it also relates to the owner of the vehicle. So if somebody gets a fixed penalty notice, the owner of the vehicle, if it is a commercial vehicle, can also be stung for the fine as well, making them responsible for their employees or for the person that's had the vehicle. It seems to be logical to me to make sure that we keep our countryside and our cities beautiful without throwing stuff out of the window. Of course I would take an intervention.
Thank you, Convener, for taking the intervention. I am actually listening to what you're saying. But in regards to, you were saying, the owner of the vehicle, if it was a bus company, how on earth can they stop passengers from opening the windows and chucking their rubbish out? Or minibuses?
Well, that's thank you, and I'm delighted you're listening. But I don't think it has to be a mandatory fine. What I'm saying is where the fine is imposed, that the minimum level is £500 to make it sensible. And you would have to take into account that actually if it was a passenger throwing it out of the window, that's slightly different to the driver in a commercial vehicle. But we all know, and we see it everywhere we go. So that's the premise of my two amendments. And I'm delighted to throw it open to any other member who wants to say anything. Graham Simpson.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Convener. I've been listening very carefully to what you've been saying. And I think this must strike a chord with probably every single member here today. And I've mentioned previously during the course of this about litter picking. I'm sure most of us have been litter picking. I just recall when I was litter picking in a wooded area next to the East Kilbride Expressway, which is a dual carriageway, and there was litter everywhere. And you know, it had to have been thrown from vehicles. Some of it wasn't. I mean, there were sofas in there and, you know, deep into the woods, but a lot of it must have been thrown from vehicles and inaccessible to the council. So I know you said, Convener, somebody's got to come and clear it up. Sometimes that somebody is just a volunteer and it's not the council. And sometimes the litter, particularly bottles, can be just left for years unless somebody comes along and picks it up. So if I had a vote, I don't have a vote on this, but I would be strongly supporting your amendments for the reasons outlined.
Thank you. If no other member wishes to speak, I'll call the Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and I understand your intentions here. It isn't appropriate to throw litter from a vehicle, and I understand the frustration that we all have about the amount of litter on our roadsides. The bill, as it's drafted, creates flexibility for Scottish ministers to set the civil penalty charge at an appropriate amount and will also allow for consultation with local authorities and other stakeholders in respect of the penalty charge amount. So I can't support these amendments, because new section 888C subsection 5, which is inserted into the Environmental Protection Act 1990 by section 14 of the bill, provides a regulation making power to ministers to set the amount that may be imposed by way of a civil penalty charge and to increase that amount. The civil penalty regime provided for section 14 of the bill allows for the registered keeper of a vehicle to be issued with a civil penalty charge where an authorised officer is satisfied to the civil standard, and that's on the balance of probabilities, that a littering offence has taken place from the vehicle. Your amendment, Convener 119, would set the civil penalty vastly higher than the current fixed penalty charge amount for a littering offence, which I understand why you want to do that. At the moment, it's currently fixed at £80, but it can be increased by secondary legislation to a maximum of £500. And this would make the civil penalty amount for the littering offence from a vehicle disproportionate, I believe, with respect to the nature of the offence. Yes, I will.
Thank you very much, Minister, and sorry to stop you in full flow, but it would be very helpful for me before you conclude your comments if you would give me an indication of what level the government thinks a fixed penalty notice would be appropriate for somebody who owns a vehicle allowing rubbish to be dumped from it.
Well, that's what I've already said, that there would be in consultation with local authorities about the appropriate amount, and there would be a certain degree of scrutiny on that in secondary legislation. It wouldn't be for me to say at the moment what I think that should be, because that would be done in consultation. At the moment, it's £80. Whether that should be higher or not is something that can be done as a result of what we're putting in this bill here. So I'll leave it there, Convener. In the interest of time, I'm sorry I can't support your amendments. I understand the reason behind them. I believe that setting it at £500 is disproportionate.
Thank you very much, Minister. Now, I think before I do my summary, I think Jackie Dunbar just wants to make a quick declaration.
Yes, and I should have learnt from the past previous 3 days that I should have done this at the start, so my apologies, Convener. I would just refer members to my register of interests, because I was a local councillor for Aberdeen City Council for the first year of this Parliament session.
And I think your actions have sparked Douglas Lumsden to follow you on this particular issue.
Yes, Convener, I'll follow Jackie on that. Just to remind everyone that on my declaration of interest, it showed I was a local councillor at the start of this session.
Thank you very much. And therefore, I am to wind up and press a withdraw amendment 119. What I would say at this stage, I'm disappointed that the Minister is not prepared to give us an indication of what is an appropriate fine, and that the Minister suggests that going from £80 to £500 is disproportionate and unreasonable. What I would say to you, what is clear, committee members, is that £80 isn't working. If £80 was working, we wouldn't see all the rubbish that we see down the edge of the road. Therefore, I absolutely believe that by sending out a strong and clear message to people that it is unacceptable, I would take an intervention.
Just to ask the member if AV has any idea of how many of these fixed penalty notices have been issued over the last 5 years, and maybe because there is not a strong enough deterrent, nobody's getting caught, that's why it happens. Would you agree with that?
Thank you, and I don't know the specific answer. I did try to do some research on Moray Council on how many notices they'd issued for fly tipping, or how many fines they'd issued for fly tipping, and the answer was very few, if any, and I don't think there were any. Bob, you wanted to come in. I'm very happy to give way to you.
Thank you, Convener. Just as Jackie Dunbar has been, of course, I'm listening intently. I'm just wondering if the relationship with enforcement is not so much the amount of the fine, but effective enforcement in the first place. Because if someone threw something out a car window and they knew they would be fined £80, they're pretty unlikely to do it. But likewise, at £500, but throw it out the window and they think it's not going to be detected, then the size of the fine may not be the underlying deterrent, and the deterrent is you may get caught and you may have a fine levied. So I'm just wondering if the Convener's consideration of that.
Mr Dorris, you're of course quite right with your comments that it's all about enforcement, which is why I would support more police men and women in Scotland on the streets. But I think if I'd made that part of this bill to ensure that the enforcement was carried out, I might not get away with it. Mr Dorris, happy to give way, and then I'm going to conclude.
Surely, just for clarity, I'm sure the Queen is not suggesting we should employ more police officers to have a force simply to detect people throwing litter out of car windows. There may be other uses for police officers.
And of course, Mr Dorris, you're entirely correct, but if there are more policemen and women on the streets, that's unlikely crimes will be committed in the first place. So my argument is simple, and I think it's disappointing that the government can't support this, especially in rural areas which are blighted by this particular problem. You know, I would say to you at the moment, there are areas on my farm at home where I do not put young calves next to the road, because the chances are they will eat plastic bottles, they will choke on them, and if it doesn't kill them, the veterinary bills are considerably more than £500. So I would ask the Minister, if you're not going to support it, and I will listen to the votes of the committee, that you actually come up with a figure and look at working with me post this to work out a minimum figure that would be appropriate. So I am pressing my amendment. So, therefore, the question is that amendment 119 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 3 votes for. There are 4 votes against. The amendment is not agreed. The question, so I now call Amendment 120 in the name of Edward Mountain, already debated with Amendment 119. And my question is whether I'm going to move it or not. Because the First Amendment wasn't agreed, I'm not moving it. So therefore I call the Amendment 115 in the name of Sue Webber, already debated with Amendment 106. Douglas Lumsden, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is, Amendment 115 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. I therefore call Amendment 68 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. I remind members that Amendments 68 and 69 are direct alternatives. Graham Simpson to move or not move. The amendment is not moved. I call Amendment 69 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not move.
Moved.
The question is, the Amendment 69 be agreed? Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 70 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. And I remind members again that Amendments 70 and 71 are direct alternatives. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
The amendment is not moved. I call Amendment 71 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 71 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yeah. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. The question is that Section 14 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yeah. We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 72 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 196. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I call Amendment 116 in the name of Sue Webber, already debated with Amendment 106. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 116 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against. The amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 117 in the name of Sue Webber, already debated with Amendment 106. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is, Amendment 117 be agreed? Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against. The amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 73 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. I remind members that Amendments 73 and 74 are direct alternatives. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
That's not moved.
Not moved. I call Amendment 74 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 74 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against. The amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 75 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. I remind members that Amendments 75 and 76 are direct alternatives. Graham Simpson to move or not moved?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 76 in the name of Graham Simpson, then already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
That one's moved.
The question is, Amendment 76 be agreed? Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against. The amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 77 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not moved?
Not moved.
Right, the question is that Sections 15 and 16, are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment now 169 in the name of Lorna Slater in a group on its own. Minister, can you move and speak to Amendment 169, please?
I move Amendment 169, and this amendment responds to requests from local authorities for powers to issue fixed penalty notices in relation to offences and regulations under Section 140 of the Environmental Protection Act 1990, which ban the supply of environmentally harmful items. This was initially raised in the context of the single-use plastics ban and was raised by Trading Standards during the consultation of the draft regulations banning the sale and supply of single-use vapes. At present, the only option for local authorities is to report any offences under these kind of regulations for prosecution. But Amendment 169 would add a new provision to the bill to provide a regulation-making power for ministers to enable local authorities to issue fixed penalty notices to individuals or businesses for offences in these kind of regulations. It would allow for more effective and proportionate enforcement of these offences and give powers to local authorities that already exist in the rest of the UK. Convener.
Thank you. Does any other member wish to speak on this? Monica.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome the amendment and agree with the intention of having more effective enforcement. It's a theme that's come up in the debate already with this bill. I just wonder if the Minister can say what assessment the government has made of the resourcing requirement around this. We know that when there's additional expectations on local authorities, particularly around enforcement, that does take time and resource on the ground. So I just wonder what assessment's been made, and are there opportunities to work a bit more smarter in this area as well?
Yeah, but this amendment is actually as a result of local authorities asking the previous minister to actually have this in place, because as I mentioned, the only recourse they had was actually to get the police involved, and they wanted to be able to issue fixed penalty notices. So I haven't really got any information here about a resourcing implication around this. It was actually local authorities that came to us and said that they wanted this power. So I'm making an assumption that they have the resources in place in order to do this. They're obviously having things reported to them and felt powerless. Trading standards already enforce these powers, but this just gives the local authorities the tools to do the same. If there was any resourcing implications, I imagine that local authorities would have brought that to my attention, or the previous ministers, and they haven't done so.
Thank you.
Thank you. Interesting. No other member wishes to speak. Minister, can I ask you to wind up, please?
No, I was finished already.
Okay. Yeah. And you have pressed the amendment?
I have moved the amendment, yes.
Okay. The question is, Amendment 169 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call an Amendment 170 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 157. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 171 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 196. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
OK, I call Amendment 172 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 196. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 173 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 196. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question, therefore, is that Section 17 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 174 in the name of Lorna Slater, grouped with Amendment 180. Minister, can you move Amendment 174 and speak to both amendments in the group, please?
Thank you, Convener, and I move Amendment 174. Zero Waste Scotland is Scotland's circular economy expert, and over the next decade it will play a pivotal role in accelerating and inspiring transformation in our economy and society, so that resources are valued to their maximum extent and market opportunities are opened up in Scotland as a result. Zero Waste Scotland will work with businesses, local authorities, public body partners and communities on behalf of Scottish ministers in the development and delivery of key policies such as those set out on in the circular economy and waste route map and the circular economy strategy that's proposed in this bill. Amendments 174 and 180 will ensure relevant legislation applicable to Scotland's other public bodies will now also apply to Zero Waste Scotland. This follows a decision made by the Office for National Statistics in April 2023 that Zero Waste Scotland be classified as a public sector organisation being largely funded and directed by Scottish ministers. And work is well underway to transition the organisation to become an executive non-departmental public body of the Scottish Government. These amendments insert a new schedule into the bill to bring Zero Waste Scotland into various pieces of legislation that apply to public bodies and will bring the governance and accountability requirements of Zero Waste Scotland into line with other public bodies going forward. These requirements have been agreed by Zero Waste Scotland Board and are consistent with the duties placed on environmental and economic public body delivery partners who work alongside the organisation to deliver environment and economy outcomes of the National Performance Framework. In particular, Zero Waste Scotland will be subject to the requirements of the Freedom of Information in Scotland Act 2002. Its ministerial board member appointments will be regulated by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland. Its board members will be required to comply with a code of conduct. It will be required to maintain or improve women's representation on its board. It will be required to carry out impact assessments for island communities when exercising its functions. It will also be required to have a records management plan to provide information on expenditure and exercise of functions and to comply with the statutory public procurement requirements. So it's our intention to ensure that Zero Waste Scotland is subject to equalities duties, but those duties cannot be posed. If I can just finish this point, and I will, Mr Golden. It's our intention also to ensure that Zero Waste Scotland is subject to equalities duties, but those duties cannot be imposed via amendments in this bill and will be brought separately under secondary legislation. And I'll take Mr Golden.
Thank you, Minister. What's the estimated costs of this transition to Zero Waste Scotland?
That is something that I will have to... get my officials to give me that information, and I'm happy to write to you. I don't have information on any cost in particular to this. This is something that Zero Waste Scotland, I believe, are keen to see. I'm just looking at my officials now. Yeah, I'll write to you.
Okay, thank you.
Before you go on, Minister, can I just clarify that? We'd rather you didn't write to Mr Golden if you write to the committee.
Sure,
so the committee can understand that,
Mr.
and we will make sure that Mr
so
Golden gets
that
a copy.
I've almost begun to think of him as part of the committee. That's probably what's happened there.
Thank you. Just to clarify that. Thank you, Minister. Is there anything else you want to say? Okay, Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks. I just wanted to go on record just to get my breath back. Just underline just the importance of Zero Waste Scotland since its inception, you know, as a trusted body that's able to look independently at some of the, you know, the big issues around how we move to circular economy. I think it's done some incredible work. I think this move to make it a public body, to put it firmly in and squarely into the public body's legislation is a good move. I think it underlines the status of Zero Waste Scotland. And, you know, I think that's hugely important because going forward, we are going to need that independent, scientifically robust work that Zero Waste Scotland does. And I know it does that work very closely, working with industry as well. So it's a critical role. And I think it's good to see Zero Waste Scotland and its role being underlined in this bill. I just want to put that on record, and particularly under the, you know, the leadership of Ian Gulland, which I think has been phenomenal over the years.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm going to just come in there. I'm a little bit concerned that we're about to vote on something that I don't know the costs of. That's a very uncomfortable place to be. Although I agree the principle of what you're trying to achieve, Minister, you know, if it's going to cost the entire Scottish budget, I may be concerned, but you've given us no indication. Minister.
That's something that I actually had in my notes here, but my officials tell me it's funded via existing grant aid. But if there's any more detail that I can get the committee, but I'm hoping that everyone will understand the reasons for the change in the status of Zero Waste Scotland. I think it speaks to the fact that so many amendments that we've had over the past 4 weeks are wanting to see more accountability. And I think that giving this sort of like status to Zero Waste Scotland will improve that accountability with regard to data and actions of the body.
And you summarised very eloquently why I want to support it. The problem is, if it's funded by existing grant aid, something else is going to have to give up. You can't get the same service out of £1 note or £1 coin.
There's no material additional costs to the running of Zero Waste Scotland. Zero Waste Scotland will just be more accountable in the way that I've set out in my remarks. Mm-hmm. You know, it'll have a duty to have a board that has equal representation, for example. It'll have more accountability and public sector duties associated with it. But operationally, there won't be additional costs.
OK. Bob Dorris, you want to come in?
I suppose just very briefly, Convener. Minister, I think all the time additional duties, responsibilities and accountabilities are placed upon public bodies, and the answer we get back from government is that existing resources will be suffice to take account of that. So I don't think this is an unexpected step. But what I would ask the Minister, though, is how does the Scottish Government make sure that the body will be sufficiently funded going forward? What monitoring process is in place to make sure there will be no additional burdens? We've got reassurances there won't be, but is there ongoing monitoring of the funds of the organisation, and would they approach government if they felt there was need for additional resource?
Well,
I sort of sparked this, and I've done it wrong. And as convener, I'll take the rap on the knuckle. The questions can be put to the minister, and the minister will get a chance to answer them all at the wind-up at the end. So that's the way it should have been done. I benefited from breaking the rules myself, so I apologise. And I'm going to bring Graham Simpson in, and then I'm going to get the minister to conclude.
Apologies, could be that. I was just...
I know, following my lead, and I was entirely wrong, Mr. Dorris, and thank you for pointing it out to me again, which I've already accepted. Mr. Simpson.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm with you. I think we can accept the principle of this, but I think it's not really good enough for the minister to come here with an amendment that she doesn't know the cost of. Well, she said she didn't know the cost of it, and then she said it was zero cost. So it's a little bit confusing. And given that every bill has a financial memorandum, you need to know the cost of things. I think you need to know the cost of it. You know, I think, that's basic, pretty basic stuff when we come to legislating. So, I imagine the committee will probably vote for this if it comes to a vote, but it's not process-wise. This is not the way it should be done. If any other member had brought an amendment of this nature, the minister would be criticising them, rightly so, for bringing forward uncosted amendments. That's what she would have said, and she would probably have said, "I cannot support this at this stage because we don't know the cost." Well, you know, I'd throw that back at the minister. She's come here with something that is uncosted, and then on a piece of paper that's been passed to her by an official, she suddenly says, "Oh, there's no cost." Well, which one is it, and where's the evidence?
Mr. Simpson, I understand your point, and I'm going to go to the minister. Of course, the minister will get bits of paper past them. I would expect briefings from my clerks, because the minister can't have everything right there, and that's the point of the officials around the table. So I'm not going to accept that criticism of her. And minister, I'm happy now for you to wind up.
Yeah, can I thank you, convener, for that? Because obviously, if there's not a material difference in terms of the budget required for something, it's not going to be in my notes. And obviously, the in front of me, and it's not going to be in the presentation that I give you. It was really the material difference it's going to make in terms of the responsibilities and the accountabilities of Zero Waste Scotland. So if there's not an associated cost with that, then of course it's not going to be something that I've highlighted. Obviously, convener, you have every right to ask me if there's an associated cost. I didn't have that in front of me. My officials very kindly have given me detail of that. There's not going to be any material costs in this change. Zero Waste Scotland receives almost 100% of its funding from the Scottish Government, and operations are based around Scottish Government priorities and processes. As a result of the fact that we are about to vote, or the committee is about to vote on this, there'll be a decision, there'll be a reflection on whether or not, again, this does mean a change to any kind of financial memorandum ahead of stage three, but it's not expected that it will do. In reply to Mr. Doris in particular, Mr. Doris obviously knows, and the committee knows, that Scottish budget takes into account what is required of public bodies and that budgets are set accordingly at that budget process. So I don't accept Mr. Simpson's criticism of... First of all, the way I work and the interactions I have with my officials, but I also don't accept the fact
sorry,
that I am...
Minister, sorry. With the greatest respect, I have chided Mr. Simpson for his comments. I don't think it's up to you to chide him again. I've done it once, so please do not... No, Minister, please do not do it again. I'm very happy that officials pass you information. That's why they're sitting at the table with you. I've made that entirely clear. I don't think it's worth continually pushing on that. So I'd ask you just to sum up without further chiding.
I wasn't intending to chide Mr. Simpson. I was more intending to answer Mr. Simpson. And that would be that if there is any material difference as a result of this, it would have been something that I would have brought to the committee. There isn't. Therefore, I didn't have it in front of me. And I hope that the committee is now satisfied that they have all the information they need in order to make a judgment on this amendment.
Thank you. So the question is I assume you've pressed the amendment, Minister, just if you could agree that. So the question is that Amendment 174 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. Therefore, I call Amendment 207 in the name of Maurice Golden in a group on its own. Mr. Golden, please, can you move it and speak to Amendment 207?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move Amendment 207 on waste reprocessing infrastructure. I should point out that in order for this amendment to take effect, legislation is not required, but in the spirit of the Scottish Government's Circular Economy Bill, which does have legislative requirements around the Circular Economy Strategy, for example, which doesn't require legislation in order to do, that is the spirit in which this amendment it takes place. And the background to this is the Scottish Government commissioned an excellent review by Dr. Colin Church with regards to incineration, and I would like to see this mirrored across all waste reprocessing infrastructure. The review on incineration was conducted too late, but it did identify overcapacity for Scotland, and therefore I think there's an opportunity to widen the scope of this report to commission an independent expert or otherwise to look at opportunities in which Scotland can capitalise on. So, for example, it could be anaerobic digestion linked to feedstock mapping. It could be a focus on, for example, our island communities. Orkney would be a prime example of this, which the report could identify an opportunity for an AD plant there. Happy to.
Yeah, I just wonder if the member would agree with me that perhaps part of the issue here is that some of the kind of waste processing has naturally fallen more in the realm of the energy strategy, and around thinking around how we meet energy needs, particularly around energy from waste, and less so in a circular economy space. And it perhaps historically it's fallen between the stools, between both energy and waste. But you seem to be suggesting it should absolutely be part of waste processing infrastructure.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it can actually, for Scotland, manage to send a signal to the market on, for example, a plastic recycling facility. If the Scottish Government report were able to say that due to their analysis that a plastic recycling facility, whether it's, I would suggest, one, but that would be down to the experts to focus on that. It could be around an electric arc furnace. It could be around turbine refurbishment. There's a host of opportunities within this space, and that government guidance could
ultimately influence the market. And I think there's clearly a gap because we know, let's take plastics, we know there's enough plastic in Scotland to work with a plastic recycling facility, but we don't have one. So let's get experts in to guide the market in that space. Happy to.
Thank you. I just wonder whether this report would set out, you know, what is being recycled now and what isn't being recycled. I think Mr. Gordon and I are both aware of the certain products that people put in their recycling bins that aren't actually getting recycled. So I just wonder, you know, whether it would go into that level of detail, because I think that if it did, then that would be of great interest to the public and would also help us to address the gaps.
Definitely, and a good example of that is absorbent hygiene products. For example, is there enough capacity in Scotland to have a plant which recycles them back into food-grade plastic? I don't know the answer to that, but that's what I would like this amendment to attempt to achieve. There's policy decisions layered upon this, because as we've discussed, within the scope of absorbent hygiene products, for example, it may be that the Scottish Government looks at this and says, well, we could have a recycling plant, but actually, from a policy perspective, we would like to have real nappies, and therefore that is not something that we are keen to pursue, or actually they dovetail and they work together. Until we've got the information, then it's very difficult for the government to make these policy calls. But I think this would be an excellent starting point to move up the waste hierarchy, to allow investment, whether it be private sector or government investment, in jobs, ultimately. Because from my perspective, if we follow the let the market rip approach, then we will not have the job opportunities and climate change opportunities here in Scotland, and we will end up with unintended consequences. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Just looking around to see if any other member wishes to contribute. Mark?
Just very briefly, Convener. I mean, I thank Maurice Golden for acknowledging Lorna Slater's work in commissioning that incineration review. I mean, that came on the back of, I think, a lot of cross-party frustration that the government, you know, about 5-6 years ago really didn't have a handle on what was coming in terms of incinerators, what the demand was in Scotland, given that, you know, it has a role, but very much at the bottom of the waste hierarchy rather than at the top. So I do think more, you know, planning around infrastructure is needed. I'd be interested to hear the Minister's response to this amendment, because I am sympathetic to something in this space being in legislation in this bill. Whether this is the exact form of words at stage two, I'm not sure, so I'll genuinely listen to the Minister's view on that. And if it's not, then, you know, I think potentially something could be brought forward for stage three that's perhaps a little bit more elegant and perhaps gives a little bit more flexibility for the government to respond. But I think the basic point here is that we absolutely need to be planning for the future, and that's planning for the future in terms of waste and also in energy as well. So,
thank you very much, Mark. No one else wishes to speak. Minister, would you like to
Yes, thank
respond?
You, Convener. I listened carefully to Maurice Golden, and I respect the intention behind this. I support the ambition to increase the visibility of existing and planned waste reprocessing infrastructure. And I can see the benefits very much this can bring for driving investment. But I don't consider at the moment, as it's drafted, certainly placing this requirement within the bill. But I would value the time to consider the amendment more carefully, including through evaluating costing and timing feasibilities of developing a report impact on other commitments and whether commissioning an independent review would be a more appropriate strategy. We mentioned the similar report that was undertaken in relation to incineration that was referred to by a couple of members, but Mr Golden in particular. Within the draft circular economy and waste route map, both data and infrastructure are identified as a key area of focus which will underpin the circular economy transformation that we need to deliver, and that underlines the importance of identifying what future strategic infrastructure requirements will be, both in Scotland as a whole and a place-based basis for local needs, and that's linked to MPF 4.
Thank the Minister for taking an intervention. It sounds like the Minister is not going to be supporting this amendment being brought forward today, but you know, from hearing Maurice Golden, it does seem a very important piece of work to set out exactly the direction of travel so people can invest. So if it's not going to be on the face of this bill, where do you think the government could actually bring something forward? Because I think it is actually something that is needed, and I think would bring a lot of investment. So I guess if not here, where?
So I'm going to come on to that in direct response to Mr Golden. Mr Lumsden's happy with that, I'd rather address that at the end of my contribution and my response here. I just want to give the recycling co-design as an example. Local government is going to give explicit consideration of future infrastructure requirements to support the delivery of high-performing services, alongside an assessment of potential for multiple local authorities to collaborate or partner, and the potential efficiencies and economies of scale that may offer to attract further inward investment. And that's part of that recycling co-design process, which I think is fundamental and it runs throughout this bill as well. That's going to complement the development of Scotland's residual waste plan to 2045, which will investigate and make recommendations on Scotland's long-term infrastructure requirements to manage waste. So there are processes in place, there's collaboration in place that's addressing this directly. But what I would say to Mr Golden, if he didn't press his amendment today, I'd be happy to work with them to consider both the merits of publishing such a report, whether or not it has to go into the bill. I'm yet to be convinced, but certainly I'm willing to consider whether such a report is required as part of our broader work on the circular economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I call on Maurice Golden to wind up and press a withdraw amendment to 207.
Thank you, Convener. And Mr Ruskell was right to point out that it was during the last session that the Greens and Conservatives voted for a ban on incineration. I think subsequently in the session, Labour came on board, and it was Lorna Slater that commissioned that excellent report from Dr Colin Church, which is essentially having an evidence-based approach to waste reprocessing infrastructure. But ultimately, it was done, I would suggest, a decade too late. Now, that wasn't the Minister's fault. That was a nature of timing. And I think timing is critical. If we are in a climate emergency, then we need to act quickly. I did think that perhaps this infrastructure report could be given to Zero Waste Scotland, as additional duties won't cost anything, as an option. And I think the overall thought process, I think the Minister said this is a key area of focus. I reflect back, I worked on a 2015 bioeconomy report in Orkney, and almost a decade later, there has been no improvements in an AD plant for Orkney, as an example. And therefore, there are many communities throughout Scotland who are missing out, while we appear to be asleep at the wheel. The other aspect I'd like to point out, which the Minister raised, is this, in my view, needs to be above local authority level, because if each individual local authority is looking at a plastic recycling facility, for example, they will conclude that they do not produce enough plastic for recycling, even if they collected all of them, to warrant a plastic recycling facility. Now, that is, with no disregard to local authorities, the fact is that for a facility, you need scale. And therefore, a local authority will not make that decision. Happy to.
Prevention. It's possible that he maybe missed that I said that there's an assessment of potential for multiple local authorities collaborating or partnering, just to avoid the scenario that he described.
But the requirement in many of these waste reprocessing infrastructure is a Scotland-wide approach. So by multiple, it could be 25 local authorities. Now, that's not to say that local authorities shouldn't be involved. They very much should be involved, but actually it's at a very high level that requirement, not for every facility, something like an AD plant, that could very much be done at a local or even community level. I think it would be useful to see and give local authorities an indication of what is achievable in their area. But they should be very much part of the process. But for certain other facilities, then you're really looking at Scotland-wide scale. And Scotland, let's be brutally honest, for many of these facilities is competing with Birmingham, Manchester, London for the finance to build it. And that's why we need to bridge the gap in terms of private finance, which I think this report would help to do, or the Scottish Government would need to use taxpayers' resources to provide grants. Happy to.
Yeah, we'll just give way on that point. I mean, he mentioned materials recovery from disposable nappies as being something that, you know, would be perhaps a nationwide facility. But I was wondering if he'd also reflect on the development of a facility in Fife to deal with soft plastics, the kind of plastic films that are very, very difficult to recycle and to reuse. And despite the fact that facility was developed on the back of a contract with Fife Council, it perhaps didn't have the scale to work up to on a national basis. And perhaps that's another example of where having a report which looks at the national infrastructure that's required for a problem which all local authorities have might be of use, as well as the kind of more detailed regional look at AD and other facilities that you might get individual collaborations between councils on.
I think that's an excellent point. So Fife have been at the vanguard of rolling out recycling facilities right back to the start in 2005. But I think there's two parts to this. The first part is the evidence. So on your on Mr. Ruskell's point on soft plastics, what is the sort of scale that's required to have a plant for this? And thereafter, there's a policy decision whether, and this is where advice needs to be given to local authorities, because on a tonnage basis, local authorities might decide that they do not want soft plastics in because they get less per tonne for that plastic waste. However, if there's an ability to recycle that, then that perhaps goes beyond the financials. But government has a key role, or Zero Waste Scotland, in kind of guiding both local authorities and the market in terms of the Scottish Government's vision for Scotland. What infrastructure, what jobs can be provided? Because as the member points out, where it is left to local authorities, it can be very difficult. I don't know the finances regarding Fife in particular, but would have it made a meaningful difference if Clackmannanshire or Stirling or Dundee had also been part of that consortium? And I think that's where it's very helpful for government to get involved and provide a signal, not just to the market, but to local authorities as well. But based on the comments from the minister, I'd be delighted to work with her, and will withdraw amendment 207, convener.
Thank you very much. Maurice Gordon wishes to withdraw amendment 207. Does any member wish to object? No one wishes to object. The question, therefore, we come to is that section 18 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. I call amendment 175 in the name of Maurice Gordon, already debated with amendment 5. Maurice Gordon to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 175 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are two votes for, there are five votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 176 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 5. Maurice Golden to move or not moved?
Not moved.
It's not moved. I call Amendment 78 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
Call Amendment 177 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 5. Maurice Golden to move or not move? I call Amendment 178 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 5. Maurice Golden to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 79 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 5. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 179 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 5. Maurice Golden to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that sections 19 and 20 be agreed. We are agreed. I call Amendment 180 in the name of Lorna Slater, already debated with Amendment 174. Minister to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 180 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Now, last question on this then. The question is that the long title be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you to your officials. I can now say that the bill will go to the Chamber for Stage 3 consideration on a date that is yet to be determined. So thank you all. There will be a short pause to allow a change of witnesses. I suspend the meeting. Okay, good morning and welcome back. This is the third item of business this morning is an evidence session to take stock of Scottish Government climate change and environmental governance. Welcome to the meeting, Murray McCallan, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy, and her supporting officials, David Signorini, the Director of Environment and Forestry, Annabel Turpey, the Director of Marine, Alison Gilfillian, the Head of Strategy, Stakeholder Engagement and Skills, and Offshore Wind Directorate. That's a huge area there. Kirsty Burge, the Director of Energy and Climate. Now, Cabinet Secretary, I think you would like to make a brief opening statement.
Cabinet Secretary. Convener, thank you very much, and good morning to you and to members of the committee. I will take the opportunity this morning just to make some very short remarks. Firstly, to start by noting that since I accepted your invitation to appear this morning, we have had confirmation of a surprise or a snap UK general election. Apart from my colleague, the Minister for Climate Action, who has appeared in respect of the continuance of legislation, I think I am probably the first minister to appear in front of a committee since that election was called. Now that we are facing this election, the First Minister has sought advice from the Permanent Secretary as to what it is appropriate for ministers to commit to or to confirm as it being intended to be taken forward whilst we're in a pre-election period. The First Minister is awaiting that advice from the Permanent Secretary, and until I am in receipt of it, I'm afraid I must err on the side of caution to an extent when it comes to future plans and confirmed commitments. And of course, all of that is in the context of the First Minister having set out his high-level priorities last week and his intention to bring forward a programme for government in June. All of that is under consideration, and I have to be careful about what I say today. However, what I will do is just briefly cast my comments back to set the scene for our discussion. Firstly, that Scotland has nearly halved its emissions between 1990 and 2021, whilst our economy has grown by 57%. A very helpful statistic, I think. We continue to decarbonise faster than the UK average, and Scotland, I believe, is in the process of becoming a renewables powerhouse. Now, this progress will continue. In this financial year alone, we've committed £4.7 billion to support the delivery of our climate goals. And on the 18th of April, we announced a new package of climate adaptation action measures to support our transition to net zero. And it was always my intention that that policy package would be taken forward alongside the already committed to actions this year, not least the Land Reform Bill, the Circular Economy Bill, agricultural transformation, and work to decarbonise Scotland's buildings. I also confirmed the need to take forward a climate bill to make adjustments to our legislative framework in the name of facilitating continued progress. I'm sure the committee will want to get onto that today, so I'll say no more on that. In the meantime, I note that the committee have had a number of helpful sessions, not least with the Auditor General, whose comments on our improvements to climate governance in Scottish Government I welcome. In short, convener, it has continued to be a busy period for climate action within the Scottish Government in terms of budgetary matters, policy matters, and legislation. And with the new First Minister placing climate amongst his top four priorities and being halfway to net zero, I believe we're well placed to continue delivering, and that's my focus. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm conscious of what you said. I'm also conscious of what the presiding officer said in the chamber last week about the need to continue with the work of the Parliament without politicking going on in the background. So there is a fine balance there. So, Cabinet Secretary, it appears as convener that I get the chance for the first question. So my first question to you is... we heard earlier this year that we weren't going to meet our net zero targets and there would need to be a climate change bill. We've heard various iterations of when that's going to be laid and what it consists of. Can you enlighten us as a committee on when it's going to be laid and what's going to be in it?
Yeah, I shall, convener, to the extent that I'm able, given the pre-election period. I suppose just first of all, there's a little bit of context that I think it's important for us all to wrestle with, and that is how it came to be that we have to, as I described it, adjust our legislative pathway to 2045. And I think it bears discussing this morning that, first of all, grounding our emissions reduction pathway in scientific advice is, I think, the best and only way to approach this. It's worth remembering that when the Parliament set the 2030 75% reduction, the Committee on Climate Change view at the time was that 75% went beyond what was reasonably feasible or within the number of pathways that they had set out. And I think that they had recommended somewhere in the mid-60, 64 to 68%, if I remember correctly, would have been the right target for 2030. Now, the government at the time wished to be ambitious, and my predecessor, Rosanna Cunningham, I understand, recommended 70%. It was then a Scottish Labour Party amendment to 75%, which the whole of the Parliament got behind, except I think Green colleagues who, if I understand, wanted to go a little higher. And the reason that I set that out is because the committee advice following passage of the bill was that we find the legislated 2030 target of a 75% reduction in Scottish emissions goes beyond any of our five scenarios for emissions reduction by that date. And I say that to make absolutely clear my view that it is not any inaction on behalf of the government in the meantime, which has necessitated the need to change this. This was always beyond what was possible, and the legal obligation around it has crystallised under the climate change plan, so I must now change it to make progress. On when the bill will be introduced, I want to do this as fast as possible, indeed there are deadlines by which it must be done, not least the production of the climate change plan draft itself under the current framework. I cannot confirm today when it will be. As I say, that would have been work that was underway in respect of our programme for government. Because of PIRDA and the advice we wait, I can't give a timeline. In terms of what it will include, again, this will be clearer to the committee once the bill is published, but during my statement I already set out my intention that we would seek advice from the Committee on Climate Change on the new trajectory to 2045, retaining 2045, that we would move away from annual targets, which the CCC in their recent letter have confirmed are susceptible to annual fluctuations in weather, for example, and move to a carbon budgeting approach, again, always set according to advice from the Committee on Climate Change.
Okay, so I make the observation to you, I think the statutory deadlines is that it would have to be introduced no later than November to allow it to be agreed and passed through the parliamentary system by the end of March. But given that this is going to cause, in my mind, a huge amount of interest out with the Parliament, trying to rush it through without giving the committee proper times to take evidence on it would be a huge mistake, I would suggest, and I think we need to be given that time, which may start, I think the committee would rather it was sooner rather than later, so that we could trawl for that input from people across Scotland. So I'm not entirely convinced why I don't understand why you're not in a position to say when it'll be laid, and I'm not in a position to understand whether you could give us an indication whether it's going to be a two-page bill to remove targets and change it from a climate change plan to carbon targets, whether you can give us that today. It would be helpful, Cabinet Secretary.
Convener, I cannot confirm the time for introducing the bill today, but I completely take on board your comments about the committee requiring sufficient time for scrutiny. I want to see that happen too. And of course, you're quite right to point out the deadline under the current regime for when the climate change plan would be due. So that's absolutely uppermost in my mind. And by way of content, again, I cannot confirm that today, but I have indicated the main points of the bill. And I'll also go further by saying that it's very much my intention to keep it as slim as possible. I want to retain as much of the original framework as possible and make the adjustments that are necessary for continued progress.
And I hear your comments, Minister. My slight push back on it is that the committee is starting or has started stage one consideration of the Land Reform Bill, which is a large bill. And as I've mentioned it myself, I will remind you and members around the table that I am a farmer in Moray and I am a landowner, although the size of my holding is not affected by the Land Reform Bill, but that's on the table. But that will require a considerable amount of work, and I see problems coming down the track to balance all the legislative programme that's there, and it would be wrong of me not to mention that, which I have done. On the basis, I'm not going to get much more on that. I'm going to move to Mark Ruskell for his comments. Questions, sorry, Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and morning to Cabinet Secretary and officials. I'm just going to go back then to 2019 and the setting of that target and the aftermath of that. I mean, you say, Cabinet Secretary, that the advice in the Climate Change Committee was to go for a lower target. But they did write to Rosanna Cunningham, who was the Cabinet Secretary at the time, and say in 2020 that while it would be extremely challenging to meet that 2030 target, they didn't recommend changing the target. And indeed, they pointed to a number of areas where they were looking for accelerated action from that government at the time. Earlier start to engineered greenhouse gas removals, early decarbonisation of Grangemouth cluster, accelerated scrappage of high carbon assets, additional retrofit of hybrid heat pumps. Can I ask you, in retrospect, what lessons the government has learned from the setting of that climate change plan that followed the 75% target? Because it does appear that you had, at that time, in 2020, strong warnings from the Climate Change Committee about where ambition and action needed to be ramped up, and yet it didn't appear in the climate change plan.
Yes, absolutely. And I do very much want to come on to lessons learned, because I see the forthcoming bill as being the lessons that we as a parliament have learned since we were quite right to set very ambitious targets a number of years ago. I think, first of all, it's worth exploring a little more what Mr. Ruskell has rightly said about advice given by the CCC in the aftermath of the passage of the legislation. Now, this goes to an extent to the core of the CCC's function as a statutory advisor. They have to advise on the legislation as it's set, and therefore we're not going to advise the government, the parliament, to change the legislation. Elected politicians had made that decision, and their role was to give advice on how to fulfil it. And in that letter of, I think it was December 2020, to Rosanna Cunningham, they set out some scenarios, as Mark Ruskell says, which, I quote, could potentially reduce emissions, and which, I quote, Scottish Government may wish to consider. Now, amongst these were, as you say, an early start to engineered greenhouse gas removals. This relates to what we call BECCS, which is bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, or direct air capture with storage. Now, the CCC's consideration at the time was that these would come on stream around the early 2030s. And what they were saying in that advice was, if they were to come on stream earlier, that could assist in us reaching our newly set targets. But this was entirely within, almost entirely within, the gift of the UK government in respect of carbon capture and storage infrastructure coming on stream. The fact is, we have not seen, as the CCC said, that could be done earlier. Indeed, we have seen a slip in the deployment of carbon capture and storage. So I point out there that one of the first interventions was not something that the Scottish Government could directly control. Again, their second recommendation, early decarbonisation of the Grangemouth cluster. Again, this very clearly relied on the deployment of carbon capture and storage as a key means of industrial decarbonisation. And again, we all know that for a variety of reasons, which we don't need to get into right now, CCS has not been deployed across the UK at the speed it, never mind we thought it might, sorry, that we thought it might, never mind on an accelerated timetable. But in terms of lessons learned, I think there certainly are lessons that I would wish us to learn. First of all, I think the most important one has to be following the independent advice of bodies like the Committee on Climate Change when it comes to setting our targets. And I would ask colleagues across Parliament to work with me in doing that when we come to look at the new bill. I will be seeking advice from the Climate Committee on Climate Change on the appropriate levels of the carbon budget. And I will be intending myself to follow that, and I'd ask Parliament to do so as well. I think we also need to set a framework which is capable of recognising that contextual issues will arise from time to time, not least pandemics and wars on the continent, which disrupt our ability to an extent to make transformational change. I'd also like us to, or I'm certainly reflecting on the fact that we are a devolved nation. We are seeking to implement transformation right across our economy and our society, and not all the tools that we would need to do that are within our gift. And I point back to, for example, the deployment of CCS.
Okay. I mean, you point to a number of areas there where there are dependencies on the UK government, and I suppose going forward we need to understand how much that continues to limit our ability to meet that 75% target. But there are areas here that were pointed out by the Climate Change Committee as areas for action going back to 2020. So heat pumps, you know, we've only just got proposals now for a heat and buildings bill, for regulation and for an action plan on heat and buildings. So it's taken, you know, the best part of 4 or 5 years before we've even got to a point where there's a plan in place. We don't yet have a plan for decarbonisation of the Grange Mouth cluster. So I guess I would say to the Cabinet Secretary, I mean, you're now the Cabinet Secretary in post. This is a different government now. But what can be learned in terms of ramping up action? Because we have seen a failure to really deliver on the action from the climate change plan. And I believe it was, you know, cross-party committees of this parliament that pointed to well over 160 recommendations for improvement on the back of that climate change plan. I don't think the government took on board all of those concerns. And what we're left with now is a deficit in terms of action that will remain regardless of what the target is set at, regardless of whether you move towards a 5-year carbon budget or not. There are still things, low-hanging fruit, that are sitting there waiting for action. And yet, you know, we're not seeing that progress at sufficient enough scale.
I entirely respect Mr. Ruskell's views. I would disagree to an extent that there is low-hanging fruit left. I would suggest that the actions that we now need to take to close the remaining half of our targets are some of the most difficult. They go right to the heart of the way that people live their lives. Legislation you rightly refer to in respect of decarbonising our homes. That's government legislating for what happens in every home in the country. That is not low-hanging fruit. That is deeply complicated, multifaceted, not entirely deliverable by public money, and requires genuine cross-working. Now, it's absolutely essential if we are to make the progress that we need to make in emissions reduction, and therefore we must take it forward. But I would push back on anything that has to be done now as being low-hanging fruit. And I think what I would also just say is that I've said it before, I'll never say that the government has done everything. I'll never say that we've absolutely maxed out and that we are doing everything that we can and nothing else is required. That's just simply not the case. It will not be the case until we're at 2045 and we've reached our mid-century target. But what I also don't accept is that there's been inaction on behalf of the government, not least because of everything we've achieved in recent years, but moreover, because we all know that that target was beyond what was credibly deliverable in the eyes of the climate scientists at the time.
I mean, it's not for the CCC to advise on all the aspects of climate science. I mean, it's for them to give advice to government about pathways and how to meet what has been agreed in terms of targets. The 75% target still only gave us a 50% chance of hitting 1.5 if there was a similar action globally across the world to meet those kind of emissions reductions. So the climate science is quite clear. We're struggling. Ideally, we need to go a lot faster and a lot higher in terms of carbon reduction. But it has butted up against the political realities and the powers of this government. So what do you learn from that? Because a moral imperative is there, probably to keep the 75% target, probably to go faster and further.
but clearly this government has struggled, and there are a whole range of reasons for that, to actually get close to that. So what do you learn from that in terms of what is an acceptable pathway to go forward, and how we balance that against the moral imperative which still exists?
I absolutely agree with you on the moral imperative. I also agree that the transformation that we need, that I talked about, is never going to be deliverable without butting up against, as you described it, whether it's contextual factors, economic factors, issues across the Parliament in getting things passed. There's just no pathway to net zero that is not without complication. But we pursue it nonetheless because of that imperative that you talked about. I think, you know, you spoke of political realities. There have been issues across that the Scottish Government has tried to bring forward, which we've not managed to get cross-party agreement on. I don't want to labour that point too much, because my core issue here is that the pathway was always beyond what was achievable. So it's not caused us to have to change the 2030 target, but it hasn't helped. And I would point to low emission zones and the issues that we face there, deposit return scheme being completely derailed by the Scotland Office, and other matters. The other issue you raised, Mark Ruskell, was powers of Scottish Government. And this is something that I've had to give a lot of thought to, because A, we do not have, for example, powers over a huge area like energy, which is so critical to the net zero pathway. And at times it has been difficult to work constructively with UK government. I think there have been times when we've done it really well. We've done it in the emissions trading scheme. We've done it in the zero emissions vehicle mandate. But there's also times where it's not worked. For example, the government's been pushing for changes to fuel duty and other matters like that for a long time, CCS. And it's not been possible. So I think going forward, I would ask for as much consensus as we can possibly get across the Parliament, particularly for those more benign matters that we have to take forward. And I will have to be clear about the realities of trying to do this as a devolved government. But I will always commit myself to trying to work with the UK government, and I suppose in this context, any incoming government, on making the fastest progress possible.
Okay. Monica, I think you wanted to come in with a supplementary on that.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. I am listening carefully, and I'm just looking for some clarity, because in my time in the Parliament, I don't think I've ever heard the government until recently say that these targets were not realistic or achievable. In recent years, I've heard the Scottish Government, which I thought was correct, be proud of the targets and the ambition. And that's clearly been communicated, not just here in Scotland, but around the world, particularly during recent COPs. So is it the case that the Scottish Government wasn't being clear and straight with the public?
No. The facts of the matter are there in black and white from the time when the CCC advised Parliament on what was credible and what was realistically achievable. However, the Parliament on a cross-party basis set the targets, and thereafter it was the government's responsibility to do everything within our power to see that we got as far towards meeting them as we possibly could. Hence our desire to strain every sinew to find policies that would meet them, to I think, you know, herald the fact that Scotland had been so ambitious. And I think that, you know, that reminds me that it wasn't a bad thing for the Scottish Parliament to have done, because it did drive progress. But now I'm in a situation where I have a legal obligation to produce a plan which can, like for like, policy for policy, meet that target. That target was never within a pathway that the CCC could find. And therefore, if I don't change it, I won't be able to produce a climate change plan capable of fulfilling my legal obligations. So I have to do that now. It's driven progress in the past. It was not the wrong thing to do at the time to demonstrate ambition, but I have to undo the impediment now so we can keep moving forward.
Sorry, just the Deputy Convener wants to come in. Can I just understand something?
Yeah.
You're still producing a climate change plan. That's what you're undertaking, you just undertook to do, is it?
So we, under the current statutory regime, we obviously have to produce a climate change plan,
yeah.
But I need to change that statutory regime to tweak the 2030 target and a few other bits and pieces. But it's still very much my intention that once the bill is passed, the obligation to produce a plan will remain, and therefore we will do it against the new carbon budgets as set.
So, sorry, just so I understand,
no, of course,
it, so that you want to produce a plan, but what you're going to do with the bill is push the delivery of, or the publication of that plan till sometime in the future. Is that what you're saying?
As it stands, my intention would be to use the new legislation to, among other things that I have noted, change the timing for the production of the climate change plan so that it can come once we have the new trajectory and the new targets. Now, there's already been a huge amount of work done to have a plan produced against the existing framework. I can't solve it, and therefore I can't publish it. But it's my intention that we should move very quickly to recast the emissions targets, do it around carbon budgets, and very soon after have a climate change plan which meets those targets with policies capable of reducing emissions.
I just observed the fact that if you're scrapping the requirement to produce one climate change plan in the legislation and not producing the new one at the same time, it makes it difficult for Parliament. But Ben, I think you want to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
To your officials. I just wanted to go back to what you said about external events, because soon after the passage of the last Act, which I recall very clearly that there was significant debate about the achievability of the targets at that time based on the CCC's evidence, particularly during the Stage 3 proceedings. Then, of course, we had the global pandemic, and I just wondered if you wanted to say any more about how challenging that was in terms of redeployment of civil servants, our loss of time to bring forward legislation, less ability during those years to collaborate with local government on implementation and other stakeholders, and a general constraining of the financial resources of the Scottish Government. And indeed, that affected, from memory, the preparation of the last climate change plan, which was we managed to conclude as a Parliament just before the 2021 election, from memory. So I think that context is so important in this wider debate, and I wondered if you wanted to say anything more about it.
Yes, I will. Thank you, Deputy Convener. I wasn't in Parliament when the last Act was set. I did shortly afterwards join government, however, so was involved in the pandemic response and, of course, in the EU exit, which we all remember happened right in the midst of the pandemic. And I don't think it should be forgotten how much of a drain on capacity and resource that was for Scottish Government, local government and the UK Government, as resources were pivoted to two quite extraordinary and, at least in one of them, unexpected events. However, and it has had an impact, there's no doubt about it, not least on government capacity, but on public finances, the public's ability to absorb further change and shock. We're talking about the very important, albeit complicated, work of heating buildings earlier. I have to consider how much households are currently grappling with cost of living as we work to take that forward. It must be considered. What I would end by saying, however, is that climate change and our goals have remained a front-running priority of the Scottish Government in that time. And I think back to COVID, our economic recovery plan from COVID was about a green recovery. And I know the Deputy Convener will remember some of that work as well. We have, at all stages, put our actions in pursuit of climate and nature at the very front of government's commitments, even through that difficult period, and we continue to do so, not least with the First Minister setting out last week that climate change is among his four top priorities.
Thank you.
Okay. Douglas Lumsden, I think we're coming to you next.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just want to dig a bit deeper into sort of timescales to see what you can and you cannot answer, Cabinet Secretary. So, obviously, the climate change plan was, I think the latest it could be laid was November 24. And I guess as it stands just now, that would still be the case. But that's not going to happen because obviously we're going to have a bill that removes that that duty. Is that correct? And is it correct that you can't set out the timescales for a new climate change plan today?
Correct on both fronts. Correct that under the current regime, a draft would be due by November this year, but equally that I have to introduce legislation which will amend that slightly. I can't confirm exactly when the new climate change plan will be reduced against the new targets, but it's my expectation that there will be as minimal a gap as possible because I want to get a new plan published against the new targets as soon as possible.
So that might be this year, but might not be this year. You've got nothing to go on yet.
It will depend largely, and I think that's a really good question because it's questions I've been asking and trying to make sure the government has a plan for. It depends on when we can get that advice from the CCC on what an appropriate trajectory is. And early indications are that that may come in the early part of next year. I met last week with the interim chair and CEO of the CCC to discuss this. Their carbon budgeting work is likely to be for the whole of the UK in the early part of next year, and the devolved assessments are likely to follow soon thereafter. That may be the point at which we're able to have clarity on the targets, and I would want to see a plan produced very, very quickly thereafter.
So I guess in terms of the process after that, so it's Climate Change Committee, release that, then you come forward with a plan, and then that will include the new carbon budgets, if I'm correct. That would then come to committee for scrutiny, and we'd have plenty of time to scrutinise it at that point.
I should say it would be a draft.
Yep. And that at that time as well, that would be going into the 5 yearly carbon budgets. That would all be part of that same process, is that?
It's my intention that it be bound up as closely as possible so that we do not lose any more time than is required in setting the targets and producing the plan against them. And I would also just add that it's very much my intention that continued delivery on all of the work that's going on this year will continue in the meantime.
Okay, and this, I'm not sure if it's linked or not, and this is why I'm going to ask. In terms of the energy strategy, is that also linked to the climate change plan? So will the energy strategy then have to wait till late 25 or into 26 before that can actually be finalised?
No. I understand asking the question. There's a lot of complexities here. The energy strategy is not legally linked to the climate change plan, and it will not be delayed by what we need to do with the bill.
But that's already been delayed, so do you know when we would expect to see that back?
The energy strategy is nearing final form, and I suppose this is when I come into what I'm restricted in what I can say and what the government intends to do for the rest of the year, because we're in a pre-election period, but the energy strategy is very much nearing final form, and it will not be delayed by the work ongoing with the climate change plan.
And I presume you can't tell us if that will still have a presumption against any new oil and gas, is that correct?
I can't confirm that. That will be confirmed when the document is published.
Okay. You said earlier that you would have liked energy to be devolved, and one of the things you would have changed is fuel duty, for example. I think you seem to suggest that would make it easier for you to reach your targets. So in terms of fuel duty, did you support the freezing of the fuel duty by the UK government or not?
Fuel duty of the UK government? On the transport side, I can't recall. We'll have to get
Could you elaborate when the UK government brought that forward, etc., Mr. Lumsden, just to give me a bit more context?
Yeah, I think over the last two budgets, fuel duty was frozen. So did you support that freezing of fuel duty, or would you like to have seen that fuel duty increased, which may have potentially have made your getting to your targets easier?
Well, I think...
Sorry, I'm just scratching my head. I'm in uncharted territories as well as a convener of a committee. With whether that puts you into politics, into the thing. So I'm just cautioning you how you respond to that, Cabinet
Secretary.
Of course,
and I appreciate that, Convener. And I suppose I'll maybe try and take it back to the generality, which is that my reason for raising fuel duty is not to comment on its current rates or the way it's currently organised, but instead to point out that it should be reformed to have a climate focus, and that so long as it is in its current form, it it's charging and it's overseeing something that I think needs to be reformed. Okay. But I won't comment on the current rates and whatnot.
Okay, thanks. I'll move on to something else, and it's in regards to the letter you sent to the committee on the 10th of May. And I'm not sure of how much you'll be able to answer on this. You said in here there's a plan to deliver approximately 24,000 additional electric vehicle charging points by 2030. Can you clarify, please, whether that also includes the 6,000, up to 6,000 charging points by, I think it was 2026. Does that figure include that, or is that additional to that figure that's already been announced?
I'm just finding the text, Mr. Lumsden, if you could just give me one moment. I am somewhat limited. This forms part of the policy package that I set out with the statement, and I understand the committee's interest in it. I am limited in what I can say about its development, but it is intended to be additional to the 6,000, to answer your question directly.
Okay, thank you. And one of the other commitments on there was to develop a new integrated ticketing system that people can use across all public transport. Now, there was something in the programme for government previously, so is this something new, or is that something? Is it referring to something that was already announced?
It's a development, I think, of something that has, you know, a very common sense measure, as far as I see it, that has been under development in Scotland for a number of years. It's a development in the sense that there are parts of Scotland where you can travel with an integrated ticket already. So we do already have parts of our system where it's rolled out. But it's a development in the sense that the Transport Secretary is going to be looking to extend it across, you know, modes of travel right across the country. And as far as I understand it from her, is currently working on business case, etc., on that, because the working with industry will be very important to making it work.
And is there a timetable for that, Cabinet Secretary, or is that something you can't say?
Unfortunately, a timetable is something I can't say, but I'm sure the Transport Secretary will be able to.
I'm really scratching my head here, in the sense that thinking back to the time when I was convener in the last Parliament in 2019, when we had an election, I think it was 2019, but we had a couple of elections in that. And I'm not convinced in my mind that there were huge restrictions placed on what we could and couldn't discuss at committees. And I'm nervous about this, Cabinet Secretary, in the sense that you've obviously sought advice on this, and as a convener, I have no advice on it. So the situation may well be that post this meeting, I will take advice from the presiding officer, and it might well be that in light of some of the answers you've given, we may have to get you back in to answer some of the questions, if that is the advice from the presiding officer. So I'm just saying I'm struggling a wee bit, and I would ask you to be as open and clear as possible. And I think you were in the Parliament, not as an MSP, at the last election, so you may remember what the advice was then. No.
Well, Convener, I understand your uncertainty on it. I equally have uncertainty. I'm not in receipt of the advice. The First Minister has sought the advice from ministers, from the Permanent Secretary. We don't have that yet, mm-hmm. and therefore it makes it a little bit more difficult. I am giving as full some answers as I can. For example, in response to Mr. Lumsden's question on EV charging, I confirmed a point about the policy, i.e. it's additional. I couldn't confirm the timeline. I have to say, even if I did, I'm not the Transport Secretary, and therefore the development of policies within the policy package, which are outside my own portfolio, would... The detail of them would be for the relevant Cabinet Secretary in any case.
And I think we're going to see that Cabinet Secretary very shortly. Anyway, Douglas, have you got any other questions?
No, I think I'll leave it there. I'm quite disappointed with how little can be said in terms of politicising things. You know, we've heard about, you know, the climate change target can't be hit because of carbon capture that's reserved, and Brexit and pandemic, but we can't seem to get any answers on transport, decarbonising buildings and agriculture, but I'll leave it there, Convener.
Okay. Hold on. Excuse me. Right. Until things change, I'm running this committee to try and keep order. and to keep it sensible. So I understand your frustration, and I suspect the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, I hope the Cabinet Secretary is frustrated as well that she can't give all the answers that she might be in a position to do. So let's not have a go at each other over it. We'll be in a much clearer position after the meeting today when I've taken advice. And all I can do at the moment, on your behalf, on the committee's behalf, is to push people to give us as honest, open and clear answers that they feel they can give without compromising their position. So bear with me, Mr. Lumsden. I will take advice after this meeting because I find myself in a position which I don't understand. Bob, if my comments, therefore, have answered your question, I hope they have, but maybe it's a question you want to ask.
It's a comment, Convener, which I think is actually appropriate for me to make at this stage, and it's not remotely seeking to undermine your role as Convener. You mentioned, Convener, how this committee feels about the evidence that we've heard. Of course, what this committee will do is we will convene in private to discuss and reflect. And I wouldn't want a narrative to be given in public for what this committee considers our position to be. I'd like to finish the evidence session and we can take a considered view as a committee. And I think that's appropriate to put on the record because we're in danger of painting a narrative that all of us may not share in.
And I take that point, and I think I said that the Cabinet Secretary might be asked to come back. Of course, it will be beholden to the committee to decide what they want to do, which we will discuss in private afterwards. And on that note, I'm going to move on. I think we're now back to you, Mark, with some questions as well.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. So the Bute House Agreement obviously provided the government with a majority to drive through a number of areas of climate action, you know, regardless of whether you see those as low-hanging fruit or not, Cabinet Secretary. And you know, you've already mentioned the reforms that are needed to empower householders to improve their homes so that they're low carbon, they're cosy, you know, they're cheap to heat and future-proofed. Can I ask you then about the introduction of the Heat and Buildings Bill? What certainty can we get about the introduction of that bill at this point?
So I would reiterate what I said before about the two sides of the coin with heat and buildings as far as I see it. Firstly, that it is very complicated, requires a number of issues to come together, not least supply chain, skills, technology, public funding, private financing. It's a big piece of work and it needs very careful handling. The other side of that coin is that it's absolutely critical to Scotland's progress on emissions reduction and with buildings making such a large contribution to our emissions, there is no pathway to net zero without doing this. On that note, we have, as you know, consulted on a series of proposals. I think we've received 1,700 responses, or there or thereabouts, apologies if that's not the right figure, and we're currently considering them all and considering how the government intends to take it forward.
Okay, but the intention is still to introduce that bill.
I fear that I am getting into a territory of confirming programmes for government, which is the advice that I'm awaiting from the Permanent Secretary of whether I'm allowed to do, able to do in a pre-election period. So without speaking to legislative programmes specifically, I would just return again to the importance that I place on this work being done and the active consideration that's ongoing of the some 1,700 consultation responses.
Okay. But if there wasn't a Heat and Buildings Bill, would that make it incredibly difficult to meet any climate target or five-year budget or whatever you want to put in place?
The centrality of decarbonising our buildings to our emissions reduction pathway is such that without this work, we would have a big gap, yes.
Okay, thanks. And then, I mean, there's lots of aspects of the Bute House Agreement that I could ask about, but I think of particular interest to this committee is the Natural Environment Bill, which is pretty critical to tackling the nature emergency. And related to that, there's the change in ministerial responsibilities. We no longer have a minister in Parliament who has biodiversity as a headline responsibility, certainly in the job title. Could you Could you speak to us about that natural environment bill and about where biodiversity sits? And, you know, it's clearly not one of the key four priorities for the government, but if you can articulate where it now sits within government in terms of responsible roles and priority in relation to that bill.
Yes, I'll try and take all those issues. First of all, in terms of the government's priorities, I said earlier, and the First Minister said in the Chamber last week, climate change is one of four alongside eradicating child poverty, excellent public services and others. But I wouldn't take from it being framed as climate change that that excludes the natural environment, because the government has always been clear that these are twin reinforcing crises and they both exacerbate one another when not dealt with, and they aid one another when dealt with. In terms of not having ministers with ministerial responsibility explicitly in the headline, I think I do have sympathy with this in some respects, but in others, if we had a situation where we tried to have a title in every ministerial title, it would just become unwieldy and very difficult to manage. What is important, though, is that I, as the Cabinet Secretary, have responsibility for all of the physical and marine environment, and Gillian Martin, who I think was with you earlier this morning, has specific and explicit responsibility for biodiversity, including endangered species, in her list of responsibilities as published in the Scottish Government website.
Okay, so job titles less important, but action critical. So can I go back to that question again? Will there be a natural environment bill in this session of Parliament?
That is akin to me confirming legislative timetables, programmes for government, which I'm not able to do today as I await advice on the pre-election period. So I'm sorry, I can't confirm that. Much like the Heat and Buildings Bill, I do want to say, however, how important I think much of the work that Laura Slater was taking forward under that umbrella, working to me as she was at the time. The bill, the biodiversity strategy, its delivery plan, all of that work was absolutely critical. And I would take the opportunity to reassert the importance that I personally place on the natural environment in our work to tackle the twin crises of climate change and nature loss.
OK, but through the Bute House Agreement, there was certainty that in this session of Parliament, there would be a natural environment bill, there would have been a heat and buildings bill. Can you understand the fact there's now quite a lot of uncertainty for environmental NGOs, from the general public, about whether the action to tackle the climate crisis and the nature emergency will actually follow through in this session of Parliament?
Well, I understand that the ending of the Bute House Agreement, you know, very clearly means that we no longer have green ministers. Much of what we're referring to here, though, in respect of decarbonisation of buildings, in respect of natural environment, our SNP priorities, which we were taking forward in advance of joining with colleagues in the Greens, and will continue to take forward afterwards. And we will be looking to work with colleagues from across the chamber in pursuit of these matters.
Okay.
Thank you. I fear some of this may have to wait till the First Minister makes his announcement on the programme for government, which we'll see when that's going to be. Monica, did you want to come in on that point?
Yes, please. Thank you, Convener. I hear what the Cabinet Secretary says about the Heat and Buildings Bill and can't confirm today whether or not a bill will come forward in this parliamentary session. But building on the point that Mark Ruskell makes about clarity and certainty, not just for industry and those that we rely on to create the jobs. I'm thinking about what the existing Home Alliance has said recently about the importance of the right advice and support for homeowners and householders. I'm aware that in countries such as Ireland, there is a network of one-stop shops that provide end-to-end support and project management services to homeowners to help them upgrade their homes. We know that many in our communities are ready to go, but don't have confidence right now. So put aside the legislation and what might happen there, can the Cabinet Secretary give us an update on the work that's going on to make sure that people have the right advice and support across Scotland?
Yes, absolutely. I will do that, and I might bring in my colleague Kirsty Baird just to speak a little bit about some of the work of Home Energy Scotland and others. I absolutely agree that, you know, I've talked about the complexity of the heat and buildings work, and one of the strands of complexity is overcoming the quite substantial gap that I think currently exists between what I think we know needs to be done on paper and where the public are in respect of their expectations. And I think the Regulatory Review Group have stressed this, the Existing Homes Alliance, as you say. I think it came up in your discussion with the Auditor General as well, if I remember correctly. There is a gap, and it has to be plugged. It has to be plugged now in advance of work being done, and then there will have to be mechanisms for homeowners to access advice on what's right for them, what's right for their building type, affordability, green finance products that may or may not be available to them. And we are currently building all of that as we progress. And I might just hand over to Kirsty if there's anything to say.
No, absolutely. I mean, the civil service work in that respect obviously doesn't stop, because we recognise, you know, whether you have regulation or not, you do need easy access to so people understand where they can go for support. So we're doing work with Home Energy Scotland. We've recently had a marketing public awareness campaign of where people can get information on the type of clean heat installations they can get and where they can get support for energy efficiency measures. So that absolutely continues. But we know we've got a lot of work to do that. I mean, to say that there are some positive signs in terms of uptick in terms of people installing heat pumps and feeling more confident about that. So heat pump installation grew by about 20% between 2022 and 2023, and grew by about 113% between 2020 and 2023. So we are seeing an upward trend to some extent in uptake, but we recognise we do have more work to do to make it easy for people to undertake energy efficiency measures and install clean heat.
Thank you. No, that is helpful to hear that work is continuing. I suppose it's just making sure that there's, people have trusted sources of information, because we hear sometimes from constituents that they're a bit worried about some of the people that maybe call them up randomly. Just linked to that, because Cabinet Secretary, you talked about the importance of finance and funding. Is the Scottish Government doing any work to look at how the land and buildings transaction tax could be used to incentivise homeowners to invest in upgrading energy efficiency and installing zero emission heating?
So we didn't look at that as part of the bill consultation, but I think we're looking at all options and all levers we have to drive building decarbonisation.
Thank you.
Thanks for that. The next questions, I think, are yours, Bob.
Yes, Convener. They are. It actually follows on a little bit from one of Monica Lennon's lines of question about one-stop shops advising homeowners for what they can do. Now, a slight segue, because as part of our post-legislative scrutiny, this committee convened a people's panel to make some recommendations about in deliberative democracy about how we could do more in climate action and climate change. One of the things they wanted to see was a climate action hub, like a one-stop shop for members of the public to go to, not just homeowners, to get advice on what they could do to make a real difference in relation to climate change. And I'm conscious that £4.3 million was available for climate action hubs last year, £5.5 million this year. I was just on my phone there to check. That's £450,000 for Glasgow alone, Cabinet Secretary. I was a wee bit unaware of Glasgow's hub. I think I'll go and find out more about it now that I'm more aware of it. But how do we make sure that we get value for money for this spend? And how do we make sure it's well connected in the every community? Because there's no point in spending close to £500,000 in Glasgow if communities are not aware of its existence. Yeah. And I sit on this committee, and I was not, that's my remiss of me, of course, Convener, but I wasn't aware, Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely take those points on board. First of all, I would say that I absolutely welcome the work of the People's Panel and the work that the NetSec Committee have done with them. And I, have already written to you, convener, with some responses on that, but I would take the opportunity to thank the committee and the People's Panel themselves for their contributions and recommendations. And it's worth noting on all of this that we are due to conduct a review on our public engagement strategy for climate change, which we will do shortly, and the work of the People's Panel will feed into that. The point on the climate action hubs, I'm often wrestling with the fact that everything that needs to be done in the name of emissions reduction and support for nature means change. It means significant change across the board and on a tight timescale. And that can be very beneficial to communities, and it can also create stresses. And therefore, I very much believe that the very best climate action is locally driven, locally appropriate, and action from which communities can benefit. So that's the idea behind the Climate Hub Network. Locally driven, locally appropriate, trusted voices, as Ms. Lennon was saying, communicating about issues of climate change in their communities and according to what's needed for them. So you're quite right, we're providing around £20 million of funding during this parliamentary term to expand the climate hubs, and that has included £5.5 million this year. It's a significant chunk of money, but it gives us that fulsome coverage right across the country in a very locally appropriate manner. I take on board what you're saying about the hubs requiring to make sure that they are well known by not least locally elected representatives, but also the communities that they're serving. And Kirsty Burge and I have discussed in the past about how we make sure there is an appropriate analysis of their impact akin to the funding that they're receiving. So Kirsty can say a little bit more about that, or Bob, if Doris, if you want to.
Kirsty, can I roll something to you? As a follow-up question in relation to that, Kirsty, rather than come in twice. Of course, for me, not as an MSP, but just as a citizen of Glasgow, if I'm at the local sports centre or local health centre or wherever I go, that's where I want the information made available to me. So it's about making sure that climate action hubs are accessible to as many people as possible, and the information goes to the people rather than people go to the information. So, and longer term funding as well, which maybe probably one for the Cabinet Secretary rather than yourself, Kirsty. I get that. But I should say the People's Panel were hoping there could be a commitment there for the longer term to allow these hubs to develop their networks and their expertise.
Yeah. I'll say so on the hubs, they do community outreach. I don't know if they've been to the local football club, but they do that, and they do outreach in schools as well. And I've looked at the valuation, because we started off with a couple of hubs, and I have looked at the valuation of their reach. I don't have the figures here with me, but we do look and we do have proper evaluation as part of the hubs, and we'll continue to do that. They're still fairly new. The other point I would make in relation to this is back to the point the Cabinet Secretary made, there are many strands. Point one, engagement with the public is absolutely critical as part of the net zero transition. So we've got the hubs, we've got our Let's Do Net Zero campaign, which helps people understand the key actions that they need to take to support the transition to net zero. Then we've got engagement campaigns in specific areas. We talked about the one in Heaton Building. So there are a range of measures. We've also got climate action schools, which help pupils and others get involved in climate activities. So we're working on a number of fronts in terms of engagement. And, we will continue with the hubs. We will continue to learn how we ensure that they operate to best effect. And following this session, I think we just want to make sure that they engage continue to engage effectively with other community organisations.
And I can just come in on the point about funding.
Sure.
I suppose we are still working with annualised budgets, very stretched annualised budgets, but that makes it more difficult, as you know, from various discussions, to give certainty. But what we can do is give policy certainty. And I mentioned at the beginning the commitment of aiming for £20 million over the term. I can't confirm more than that when we've got an annualised budget. But the policy objective is there, and I hope that provides some certainty.
It does. There was a follow-up question in relation to the People's Panel. They weren't really big on long-winded policies and strategies. What they wanted was it to be short, simple and easy to understand. Actually quite similar to what the First Minister said about more concrete actions and less lengthy strategies. So I suppose the question is, there's something chiming there between what the People's Panel said and what the intention of the First Minister would be. So what consideration the Cabinet Secretary given to adopting policy in that way to make it as easy as possible for all of us to do what we need to do for our climate change commitments, but in a bite-sized chunks and easy-to-action kind of way, rather than referencing strategies and policy documents and long-winded narratives. People with busy lives want the answers or the options put in front of them in bite-sized chunks that they can act on. And that was a bit of a call from the People's Panel. Is that something the Cabinet Secretary has given consideration to?
So I sympathise entirely with the People's Panel's comments. I often find myself wading through hundreds and hundreds of pages of policy documentation and wishing that it could be more succinct with more brevity. I think the government has to challenge itself in that regard. And I've talked about this a little bit in respect of, for example, our Green Industrial Strategy, which I have asked, you know, foreground the need for brevity and conciseness. Sometimes the issues just are deeply complicated and if we are too brief, we are accused of failing to consider certain issues which are not within the document. However, I think that brings us back to the importance of community-led action. Whether it's the climate hubs, I recently visited NESCAN in Aberdeen, whether it's work with our climate cafes, who I recently visited in Dunkeld in Burnham, these are the dedicated, local, trusted advocates who are capable of taking the complex policy documents that governments have to produce and distilling that in a way that's appropriate for their communities. And I think they do a fantastic job, and I'm pleased we're able to support them. And I want to continue doing so.
OK, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Douglas, did you want to come in with a point of clarity on those questions you've heard, or something earlier?
It's something earlier, so I can come back at the
end. OK, I may just come back to you at the end, if I may. And I'm going to move to Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. How will the new proposed draft national outcome on climate action support the urgent actions necessary to reach net zero greenhouse gas emissions and build Scotland's resilience to climate change?
Sorry, Ms Dunbar, is that in respect to the National Performance Framework?
Yes.
OK. Well, I think the... So I'm just trying to remember the report in respect to the National Performance Framework and its upgrades was laid in Parliament, I think, on the 1st of May. And yes, it absolutely included a new commitment to climate action, which is about recognising the climate emergency and the extent of what I was talking about earlier, where climate change is at the core of decision-making within government. It also, if I remember correctly, brings us into line with the Sustainable Development Goals, which the National Performance Framework was always intended to mirror, but which has, I think, moved on since ours have. So I am very pleased to see the new target. I think the Finance and Public Audit Committee are the lead committee for consideration of that, and that it will be debated by the Parliament in due course.
OK, thank you. When you updated Parliament recently on the climate policy package, you're very clear that full delivery of the government's plan is contingent on the UK government reversing the 9% cut to Scotland's capital budget. So can you explain what the impact of these cuts are on realising Scotland's climate ambitions?
Yes, absolutely. So we were absolutely clear about that, and I think everybody who has heard the First Minister in recent days will have noted his clarity on the fact that whilst public finances are strained in the manner that they are, it makes decision-making for government much more difficult. Climate change and the spend that's required by the public purse is significant. I think I've described it as eye-watering in certain circumstances, but of course that leads us to the fact that the public purse can't meet it alone. We will have to find ways of leveraging responsible private funding. But that cut of up to 9% over coming years to our capital budget is very damaging indeed. We've talked about heat in buildings. We know that there's a significant capital cost when it comes to what needs to be done there. The government is under... You know, it puts the government under significant pressure. Another place we see this manifesting is in forestry. I know that my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, grappled enormously during the budget with the issue of capital funding for forestry. And that's important to me because it's absolutely critical to the emissions reduction plan. And I note Scottish Fiscal Commission, I think it was, very recently reported on the extent to which Scotland is more exposed to the high capital costs, particularly in the natural environment. It's absolutely critical to what we're trying to do in climate change, and yet it is made so much more difficult by UK having not inflation-proofed the capital budget and what that means for us.
Thank you. And given that Scotland has much of, well, does much of the heavy lifting to do with harnessing the power of our natural capital in order to reach our net zero, and the fact that for the whole of the UK to reach net zero, Scotland must do so by 2045. We've heard that in evidence before. So isn't it logical then that Scotland should receive funding in line with that work it will have to undertake?
Yes, I would absolutely say so. And again, I think a lot of this comes from the very welcome analysis from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who, you know, first of all, started off by making that really important point, which is that whilst I'm saying the costs of climate action are high, the costs of inaction are so much higher. So it's not a choice of whether we do it or not. We have to do it. They also pointed out that because of the current fiscal framework, if there is a particular climate event in Scotland, and if we are particularly exposed, for example, to a flooding event, we don't have the flexibilities to respond to that in the way we might want to. And then I think that final point about the interconnectedness of Scotland and UK's objectives and the substantial weight that falls to Scotland in terms of costs because of how much we need to do in the natural environment space, forestry being the key example there, but I would also include peatland restoration in it. So given how critical they are to the UK's path to net zero, I should very much like to see that borne in mind by UK ministers.
OK. That's all I've got just now, Convener. I may come back in later.
Thank you. Bob Dorris, you want to come in?
Yeah. The question's been mostly answered, but it does give an opportunity to use an acronym that I wasn't aware existed until preparation for today's meeting, which is LULUCF. So land use change in forestry. And I think the Cabinet Secretary was alluding to the Fiscal Commission report that it's 40% per person more expensive to meet our climate obligations in Scotland because of the nature of Scotland's landscape. And that's where perhaps a bit of partnership working with the UK government is needed to do everything we need to do as Scotland, but also as the wider UK. I suppose my question would be, has there been any discussions in relation to that to date? If Scotland does this well in terms of reforesting and peatland and whatever, does that help the UK meet its overall climate change targets as well? So is this a joint endeavour?
It very much is a joint endeavour, and I remember when I first came across the LULUCF acronym as well, Mr Dorris. It very much is a joint endeavour. In fact, the UK's pathway to net zero is contingent on a number of things, but inclusive of Scotland meeting our forestry objectives, which I think underlines how more difficult that is made when capital budgets critical for afforestation are cut when they're coming to Scotland. We have a number of forums through which I work with UK government ministers and ministers in the other nations of the UK, not least the Interministerial Group on Net Zero. We take the opportunity to raise policy and budgetary matters there, and I can assure the committee that the Scottish ministers, and certainly Gillian Martin and I in respect of climate change, will be taking all opportunities to raise with the UK government not only the need for policy progress in certain areas, really good joint working, and also budgetary priority given to climate interventions.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bob. Monica, I think you've got some questions now.
Yeah, thank you. On environmental governance, the Scottish Government's review concluded in October of last year. Is the Cabinet Secretary able to say when the Government intends to lay its statement in response to this?
I can't confirm that today, Ms Lennon, not simply because of the advice I'm awaiting on future plans, but because more substantively on the complexity of the issue and the extent to which it's caught up in the Human Rights Bill and the Right to a Healthy Environment, that is, both of those factors mean that I can't confirm today when that report will be published. What I can confirm, though, is that the responses to it, the evidence that this committee has taken, are being closely taken into account.
Thank you. Okay, well, I'll try and stick to things maybe we can developed today. So we know that environmental stakeholders have been highly critical of the scope of the review, in particular of the level of consideration on environmental courts, and some have called for a further independent review. Does the government accept the review it published was too narrow in scope, and has there been consideration given to the need for a further independent review in this area?
So my focus just now is on fulfilling the obligations under the Act, which is to publish our report, consult on it, and then report back. So whilst we're doing that, I'm not considering an independent review. I'm also not considering an independent review currently because it is my view, the government's view, that the reports, plural, that we published do fulfil our obligations under Section 41 of the Continuity Act, as I'll refer to it as. But the process is ongoing, and as I say, the feedback that we've received, the evidence that this committee has taken, is all very much under consideration just now.
Okay, I mean, there's some really serious concerns being raised, even as recently as last week. I know media reports on this, that fragile and damaged marine life around Scotland's coastal areas is not being properly protected because the Scottish Government has repeatedly missed its deadlines to protect vulnerable marine life. This has been raised just last week by the Marine Conservation Society, the National Trust for Scotland. Concerns have been raised by Open Seas. Now, these organisations point to multiple failings on the part of the Scottish Government in relation to marine conservation policy. They cite a lack of proper oversight and governance, and what they're saying is there's a failure to survey all the seabed and marine features and concerns about marine protection areas. So these are not my concerns, these are, you know, serious organisations. So is there anything the Cabinet Secretary can say today to reassure them, or are they all wrong?
No, I don't think that the stakeholders are wrong. Their views and their close concern for Scotland's oceans and seas are very important to me, and I value their input, not least because citizen science forms a really important part of the work that we do on marine protection. I suppose there's a couple of points to make. Firstly, on the substance of the issue of marine protection, we are currently taking forward, albeit somewhat delayed, regretfully, our work to complete management measures within marine protected areas. The committee will know we have 37% coverage with management measures in some of those areas. We are now working to complete that in the inshore and the offshore. We are also working to protect priority marine features, and there's a huge amount of work currently ongoing on all of that to identify the areas, identify the features that require protection, assess the socio-economic impact of whatever management measures are then consulted on, and I hope to make progress on all of that very soon. And then just to put that in the context of the original question about environmental governance, I think our report, which again I'm still reflecting on the feedback to, reflected what I think is an appropriate balance between the legislature, the executive and the judiciary in Scotland, which it is the view of the government is currently serving well the issues of environmental law.
Thank you. Now again, I think you're going to say you can't give an answer today, but the Human Rights Bill has been mentioned, the right to a healthy environment. So what is the government's view on the human right to a healthy environment? Is that something that you're still strongly committed to, even if you can't comment on the legislation today? And how important is that to improving environmental governance?
I think the existence of a right to a healthy environment, which is properly accessible and judiciable, is a very important part of a human rights bill in Scotland. I am not able to confirm a timetable for the human rights bill, again, not because of the Purdah question, but because it's the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice who is leading that bill. However, what I can confirm to the committee is that myself and my officials in environment have been very closely engaged with the development of the bill to date, including the question of a right to a healthy environment.
Okay, and final question from me, Convener, just more, I suppose, widely, to get a sense of the Scottish Government's position now in terms of reviewing wider legislation, particularly in light of developments by the European Union. This committee received a letter from Lorna Slater in her previous role, and I had a letter too in relation to my proposals on ecocide law, and I really welcome Ms Slater's support and proactive engagement on that. What is the position now from a Scottish Government perspective?
I'm glad you raised the point, Ms Lennon. The Scottish Government's position hasn't changed. I'm picking up this work from Ms Slater that I know she was closely involved with. David and I were just discussing it prior to coming to committee. I know that you've undertaken your consultation, and at the same time that we are awaiting confirmation on the position from the EU. Dave, if there's anything further that we can usefully update Ms Lennon on today, I would ask you to do so. Otherwise, I can confirm that the position of the government hasn't changed with Ms Slater's departure.
Thank you.
I'm sure you'll take it up with Monica afterwards to update her. But if the position hasn't changed, I'm happy.
And head officials, yeah.
Thank you. We've got a few questions outstanding from members. I've got Douglas, Ben and Mark. Mark, was yours on a point specifically related to the...
It was on, yeah, in relation to these
OK,
questions.
So I'll come to you first, then I'll go to Douglas, then to Ben, and then I'm going to come to you, Graham Simpson, at the end.
Yeah, no, appreciate that. I mean, access to environmental justice is critical. It's a really hard one, hard-fought-for right that communities around the world have struggled to achieve and struggled to get commitments to from governments. And that is enshrined in the Aarhus Convention, which brought parties together internationally to agree those environmental rights. I think it's very concerning that the Scottish Government is not in compliance with Aarhus. I know that there's going to be another review of this in October, but it does seem, Cabinet Secretary, given on the back of your answers today, that Scotland will remain out of compliance with Aarhus and will remain in a position where citizens are going to struggle to get access to environmental justice. Does that concern you?
I would come back to my general point, which is that the government's view, having undertaken the review of under the Continuity Act, is that the current balance is serving access to justice well in Scotland. On the specific point about Aarhus, and I think their comments are about the expense in particular of accessing judicial review. In our report, we set out a series of pieces of ongoing work which are intended to aid access to justice. That includes the right to a healthy environment, which we the development of that, which we've discussed previously. That's a core part. We also have the review of the protective expenses order, the introduction in July 22, I understand, of an exemption from court fees for Aarhus cases. And then there's matters of legal aid, etc., which are not within my remit explicitly, but within the Justice Secretary's. So we did consider the question of compliance as part of our report, and our report is clear on the actions that are currently being taken in order to aid access to justice, because I do understand that judicial review, whilst a very important means of accessing justice, is expensive.
Yeah, and those judicial reviews, of course, are only on process and not on the merit of decisions or not. I mean, if the view of those that oversee the Aarhus Convention in October is that Scotland still remains not in compliance with Aarhus, will the government take action? Or do you believe, as you just said, the balance is right and what we're doing is fine?
What I would say is that our assessment of the situation is that there's bits of work ongoing which aid access to justice, and one of those is the right to a healthy environment as part of a human rights bill. So I think we have to take forward that work and allow it to conclude, allow the Parliament to be part of that as well, absolutely. And that will, in the government's view, aid in what is a very important issue of access to justice.
Okay. Thanks, Mark. Douglas.
Yeah, thanks. And really just looking for a piece of clarification. It's been said by the government that the energy strategy can't be released because we're in a pre-election period. But while we've been in this committee today, the Scottish Government have published their national event strategy. So how can one strategy be released but other one can't?
Convener, I did not say that the energy strategy couldn't be released because of the pre-election period. The whole tenor of my position today is that I'm awaiting advice on what can and can't be said in the pre-election period. My comments on the energy strategy were that it wasn't linked to a delay from the climate change plan, and therefore it was needing completion and would be published in due course.
Oh, OK. I apologise if I picked that up wrong, but I'm sure I've heard in the Chamber as well that the energy strategy couldn't be released because we've got because we're in pre-election period. But I'll double-check back on the official record. Thanks, Convener.
I think everything will become clearer over the next 48 hours when we understand what can be allowed. But my understanding is the Scottish Parliament still continues to function. Ministers will continue to do their jobs. Civil servants will continue to do their jobs. And it's announcements that would affect the UK election, which cannot be made. So where those can be made and where there are, I think I'm sure the government will push on with it. Ben, I think you've got some questions.
Thank you, Mira. Just on that, I think it's been interesting today to reflect that when there is a Scottish Parliament election, of course, the Westminster Parliament is in no way constrained in the way that we will be in the weeks ahead. Quite an inconsistency there. Moving to positive considerations, Cabinet Secretary, you rightly emphasised in your opening statement or early on in the session, I cannot recall exactly when, about the significant progress that there's been in renewable electricity production in Scotland since the passing of the 2009 Act. And building on this, there is significant further capacity that could be realised and indeed is going to be realised in the years ahead. Part of the challenge in all of that is with the number of projects coming forward and the diversity of those projects and the government's rightful considerations of issues of biodiversity and other considerations, the consenting process is quite challenging for those who are trying to progress projects in a variety of different technologies and infrastructure initiatives. I've raised this previously in this committee and in the Chamber, as have others, about what action is and can be taken to make sure that we not only have a robust and appropriate consenting process, but also a timeous one to make sure that projects that will be consented can be advanced as quickly as possible to realise the many advantages that they bring, not just in terms of renewable electricity production, but also job creation, attraction of investment, and all the other positives. And I just wondered if you wanted to update Parliament at all, or you and your officials update Parliament at all on yeah. these matters.
Of course. Thank you. Thank you very much, Deputy Convener. I'll make a general point and then one specifically on consenting. The first one is that I consider the energy transition to be the single greatest socio-economic opportunity that Scotland has faced in many, many years, and that it's all of our jobs to make sure that things are aligned so that we can seize it in a way that benefits our economy and our people. And I think one of the, although the government has got much to do in all of that, I think it can be boiled down to creating policy certainty. And our energy strategy will seek to do that, not least by setting capacity targets for each of the renewable sectors that Scotland can deploy. I think that the second part is a stable and predictable regulatory regime, which of course is where planning and consenting come in. And I think the last thing we can do is use scarce public money prudently, well, to go, for example, where the market might not go, or to help leverage in private funding. On your specific point on planning and consenting, because it is extremely important, I have been reviewing on an ongoing basis the government's performance in this respect. And if I take something like offshore wind, where we are pioneering, not just with the technology itself, but with the scale of what we're seeking to consent in the coming years with something like ScotWind alone, before you even consider NTOG, and sorry to use acronyms, we are doing well. I think, and my colleagues from offshore wind can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the average time for the consenting of projects for our part in the process is 11 months. Sorry, I'm looking the wrong way, Annabelle. It's 11 months, and if I'm correct, we have consented a number of projects. Perhaps Annabelle can elaborate on that a little bit. But of course, marine consenting is just one part of the process, from option agreement through planning, consenting, contract for difference, operationalising, etc. One of the biggest constraints in all of that is grid connection. So whilst we will continually seek to improve what we're doing, and we are challenging ourselves to do that, to get that average down, we're currently seeing marine consents going through an average of 11 months, whereas developers are getting grid connection dates in the mid-2030s. So I think that underlines the importance of cross-UK working on the long overdue upgrades of electricity grid. But I'll maybe just hand over to Annabelle if you want to say a bit more on performance to date.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So as the Cabinet Secretary said, applications received in offshore since 2015 have taken 11 months on average to determine. Prior to 2015, they took 18 months. We have recently consulted on guidance and improving guidance and worked with developers and other groups as well, to make sure that we are continuing to think about how we make it easier to get to robust but timious determinations. Just a little bit in terms of context, to date we've consented 6,374 megawatts, and 689 megawatts of that was in April 2024 in the run-up to AR6. So again, it's the interdependencies, and apologies, that is the round that the UK government runs, which is around setting the price in the contracts for difference. So it's a big tight deadline in the consenting world. The total installed operational capacity is sitting at 1,872. So again, it points to offshore wind is very much the start of the process, but the end of the process, i.e. what we all want to see, getting turbines in the waters, involves a lot of groups across the UK. It involves the private sector, it involves ENGOs, it involves other sectors who are affected by this, it involves planning. So it that's why we're taking, as Cabinet Secretary said, very much we're joining up across the piece, because if we don't join up, then we're not going to deliver what we need to deliver. And we want to improve consenting timeframes wherever we can, but we want them to be robust determinations, because that's what actually helps get the turbines working in the water.
That's a very helpful update, and taking away from the fact that there is a good average and that there is this progress. I just think it's important for all of us, given the potential, to seek to continue to refine and improve this as much as we can. Thank you.
Thank you. So we now come to Graham Simpson for his questions. Graham.
Thanks very much. Still good morning. So good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just want to go back, just to sort of clear up in my head, going back to the very start where we were talking about the Climate Change Bill and the Climate Change Plan. So currently, legally, you have to produce a Climate Change Plan by November, but you want to delay that, and you want to introduce a climate change bill. So in order to legally not have a climate change plan by November, am I right in thinking you would need to have a climate change bill in place and passed before that?
Yes, that's correct. I really appreciate this is complicated, but I did try and set that out earlier. So part of what the legislation needs to do is change the date for when the climate change plan is due. It's currently due in draft by November, but that's under a framework that can't be met.
So the timescale of that bill would all have to be done and dusted by November?
That's correct.
Okay, that's useful. Right, so can I ask, I think the Scottish Government still likes to keep pace with European regulations, so I wanted to ask about one that I've been following for a while now, and that is Regulation 2023-1804 on the deployment of alternative fuels infrastructure. Now, I'm not expecting you to be all over the detail of that, but it is now in place, and it does a number of things. You've been asked already about EV charging. So one interesting aspect of this is by the end of December 2025, there should be one recharging pool at least every 60 kilometres, that's 37 miles, on the main road network in the EU. And it does a number of other things. It deals with, I'm sure you can look it up afterwards, but also deals with hydrogen infrastructure for road vehicles, liquefied methane for road transport, electricity supply in ports, electricity for aircraft, railway infrastructure to include hydrogen and battery power, and also easy payment for EV charging. So is that, as I say, I'm not expecting you to know all this. I don't expect you to have it in front of you. But is that a regulation that you would have the ambition to mirror here in Scotland?
Convener, I'll do my best, and I appreciate Mr Simpson being clear that he knows I don't have the detail of that in front of me. I suppose what I would say is that our, and it comes back to the Continuity Act again, that our desire, our intention is to keep pace with the EU where it's practicable and in Scotland's best interest. So we will consider EU developments on a case-by-case basis. I know that the Constitution Secretary, Angus Robertson, deals with, from a government perspective, the overarching approach to that work. And given the content of what Mr Simpson has narrated, I'm sure that this particular, I think you said it was a directive, will be a regulation.
It's a regulation.
Regulation will be of interest to the Transport Secretary principally, but myself as well, given the decarbonisation.
It's transport and it's energy.
Yep.
So it's the kind of energy that we use. And for me, I'd actually like to see this across the UK, because if we're going to encourage people to get into electric vehicles and use electric vehicles, then we need more EV charging stations. And that's what this regulation does. I mean, I'm an example of where we're failing, and perhaps you could comment on that, is I think the convener is well aware of this as well. When we're looking at the A9, we haven't even designed in a service station, you know, let alone EV charging station. So it seems to me that, you know, this kind of thing, if we want to mirror the EU, then we need to be looking at exactly this kind of thing.
Yes, and Convener, I appreciate that having responsibility for coordination of net zero policy across the government does absolutely require me to have a scope right across government, although I can't bring the absolute certainty on matters that are outside my portfolio to the committee that I would want to for those that are. On the point about EV charging, though, Mr Simpson's absolutely right. Access to charging is absolutely critical. I would take the opportunity to remind the committee that Scotland has the best network of and the most fulsome network of public EV chargers per head of population anywhere in the UK outside of London, and the government has very recently committed to those additional 24,000 points by 2030. So we recognise the point that Mr Simpson makes, and we're working on the deployment of EV charging from a rather good position.
Okay. Maybe I could ask for a written response on the detail of the regulation. You would, of course, want to write to the committee and not me. I shall leave it there.
Thank you. I'm just looking to see if there's any other committee members want to ask a question. Well, I've got a very simple one at the end, Cabinet Secretary. The Paris Agreement was suggesting that we could limit temperature increases to 1.5 degrees centigrade, and there's a lot of scepticism that could be reached or at this current time. So on the basis that temperature increases will drive your climate change plan for the future, what temperature increase are you working on for Scotland to make sure that we've got the right plan in place?
A very simple question, Convener. So I think in respect of... I might take the question just globally and then for Scotland. The Paris Agreement and 1.5, and you said there's scepticism of whether that can be met. Of course, 2023 was the hottest year on record. We surpassed 1.5, I think, for the whole year, if I remember correctly. But, of course, it's not sustained and therefore isn't breaching the Paris Agreement, but it is deeply concerning and it's unacceptable. And at COP28... the global stocktake and the work that came from that and the commitments to in terms of fossil fuel, for example, I think we're recognised as meaning that 1.5 could globally be kept alive if the actions of states met that and were commensurate with it. In respect of Scotland's position, noting, of course, that Scotland can't solve the climate crisis, but the climate crisis can't be solved without countries like Scotland doing our bit, it would be my understanding that retaining 2045 in our legislation would keep us aligned to 1.5 degrees, but these are the questions and the invites that I will be both asking and seeking from the CCC when it comes to setting those carbon budgets.
Okay, so when you set your climate change plan and the plans for the future, you must have a temperature in mind that will be the temperature that you have to work with to achieve all the things, because, you know, if it gets too hot, you can't achieve some of the plantings that you want to achieve, some of the rewilding, if that's the right thing, if things have dried out. So I wondered if there was a temperature that you had in mind. You're just going to work to 1.5 and keep your fingers crossed that it's going to be the right figure, is it?
It's not a case of keeping fingers crossed. I think 1.5 is the point at which there is consensus that the dangers of climate change become unmanageable and in some cases irreversible. 2045 being our target for net zero is, as I said, I understand, aligned with 1.5 degrees. It's absolutely my intention that we will retain 2045 as our mid-century target, and then it will be for the CCC to advise me on the trajectory to get there.
Well, I always thought I got the last question, but Mark Ruskell wants the last question, so I'm happy to bring him in.
I mean, is it possible, Cabinet Secretary, that the climate science may say that we need to meet net zero before 2045?
I shouldn't prejudge something as significant expansive and complex as climate science, but I think the consensus just now is that we should be working towards 1.5. Incidentally, in respect of our adaptation work, the Committee on Climate Change advice is that we prepare to adapt for 2 degrees, assessing the risk of increases beyond that, just for context.
Do you think there's a pathway to meeting net zero before 2045 in terms of action that's required?
I think 2045 remains the correct aim. The CCC have recently confirmed their view that 2045 remains the correct net zero target for Scotland, and I'm glad to take the opportunity in closing today to restate the value that I put on following science so that it's feasible as well as ambitious.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I think that's all the questions that we've got, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you to your officials for coming as well. Of course, this may be the last time we see you before you go on leave, and I think on behalf of the committee, we'd wish you well in the next few months. And that concludes our public part of today's meeting, and we're now going to move into private session. Thank you very much.